Webinar is now live.
All right, excellent. Well, they're rolling in, guys. So welcome everybody into the first annual finale DMX webinar series. We've got a wonderful, friendly, and excited group of panelists here tonight, including myself. We've got, I don't know how your screen's laid out, but we've got Joel, myself, Joel Robinson from Cobra, Scott, I'm from Cobra, Drew from Finale 3D, Will from Finale 3D, and then we've got Ryan and Jonah, if you guys want to say hi. I know you're hiding behind your, say hi.
Hello.
Hello, everybody.
There we go.
Sneaky tonight.
They're being sneaky tonight. So we got a couple of sneaky Ryan, a sneaky Jonah, and we may even have a cameo from Dusty from Finale here shortly, hopefully, as a panelist with us, but we'll see how that goes. Oh, there's Dusty. How are you? Say hi, Dusty. He's connecting his audio.
Dusty's mysterious.
He's also mysterious. We have three mysterious guests here. Yeah. Hey.
There he is.
All right. Excellent. So again, thank you guys. So a couple of points. We'll probably get started here in a minute or two once the attendees kind of bounce out, which I'm sure they will be. If you're brand new to the webinar series from Cobra, you'll notice there's a couple buttons at the bottom. There's a Q&A button and also a chat button. We like the Q&A button, I think, for asking questions. So if you do have questions, try to try to format them nicely within the Q&A section. Try to be specific with your questions. Sometimes it's tough if you're kind of saying something really fast and we don't understand. And so present that. Also, if you have any like general support questions or things that may not be as much related to the webinar, you can always email us or Finale directly, I'm sure. Also, there's a chat window, and go ahead and make sure in the two dropdown that you've got both panelists and attendees selected. This will introduce yourself, say hello. Make sure that it's all panelists and attendees, or we just get it versus everybody. So go ahead and say hello to yourselves. With all of our Cobra webinar series. This is pretty chill. We like these to be relaxed and enjoyable. So this is a non-pressured environment. We're not going to rush things. Enjoy yourself and kind of hang out with us as we go through some of these things. We'll try to be slow and careful. And also at the end of this, we always have a Q&A session. So if you do have questions, we'll do our best to answer them. We won't remove them from the Q&A window until we've at least addressed them. But we'll also have a Q&A session at the end where we can speak just more openly and have just some conversation about features. So we'll stay as long as you guys want to make sure you're happy. So perfect. It looks like we're probably balanced out here with the attendees. So what I'll do is I'm gonna hand this over to Drew, and Drew's gonna kind of do his little introduction and let these guys from Finale do their thing. We'll jump in as needed from Cobra. But just kind of, enjoy. So off to you, passing it off to you, Drew.
All right. Thanks, Scott. Really appreciate that. First, I'd just like to thank Scott and the entire Cobra team for having us here as guests tonight within the Cobra Classroom webinar series. So it's a privilege to be here. As Scott said, my name is Drew Espenshade. I'm with Finale Fireworks. I'm also here with my colleague, Will Harvey, our founder and CEO. What I'm going to do is just give a little bit of introduction, a little introduction content, and then we'll jump into the main event, which will be led by Will. So first, a little history. Over 10 years ago, Finale Fireworks really pioneered visual fireworks design, especially for the backyard hobbyists and enthusiasts. And around that same time, Cobra and Scott Smith was pioneering cost-effective wireless firing systems for backyard and now professionals as well. Both companies throughout the last 10 years for that period of time have been focused heavily, if not exclusively, on fireworks. And this is the day where we're really turning the page. We're starting a new chapter, and we're doing that by adding DMX. And DMX allows you to add things to your shows and create new types of shows that we're calling hybrid shows, such as flames and spark systems, and especially lights, which you'll see tonight during our demo. So this kind of is a new frontier. It's a new beginning. This is, when we first started out years ago, we changed the way and brought the ability for hobbyists and enthusiasts who never had access to visual choreography software, or in the case of Cobra, never had access to professional grade firing systems cost effectively. Now we're turning that page again. And, this we think is going to really revolutionize the way that shows are done, because now you don't have to have a separate mechanism for controlling your pyro versus your special effects elements like your lights or your flames or spark systems. And you don't have to have a separate design ecosystem. You can design your entire show in Finale, and you can produce your entire show with Cobra and have everything synchronized together seamlessly, which if you have experience doing DMX using consoles and other things, you know that it can be very complex to try to bring everything together. So we hope you really enjoy what we had to show you tonight. Before we jump in, I'm going to go ahead and show you a video of a show that we produced in preparation for tonight that includes some moving lights. It's not a hybrid show. It does not include pyro and DMX, but it's an indoor moving light show that gives you a good example of what's now possible in Finale 3D as the design tool and fired or produced, controlled by Cobra. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm gonna go ahead and share.
And that was really well said, Drew. And if you click on the three little dots on Drew's rectangle in the upper right, if you pin his video, that may also help to, and hopefully that helps to increase the, or not. So that's not required, but anyway, that was probably counterintuitive advice, but.
All good. You're in charge, Scott. Can you guys see my screen all right? Okay, perfect. All right, let's check it out. Alrighty, I'll just mention right before turning it over to Will here that the show that you just saw, hopefully you saw it, was designed entirely in Finale 3D in the version of the software that's available now. We'll talk more about that at the end tonight, and shot entirely or controlled entirely by Cobra. So that's very cool.
Will, one module, by
one
the way.
One Cobra module, yes.
One module did that, just so you know.
So imagine what you can do with your 1072Ms. great, that was awesome. Will, go ahead and take it away.
Terrific, thank you, Drew. Thank you everybody for joining. I have three examples that I'm going to walk you through. The first example is a very simple flame example. The second example is a fancy flame example. And the third example is a moving heads light show. The third example we're actually going to do interactively. And I'm going to pick up my computer, walk upstairs to the room that you just saw in the video that Drew showed. And we will then download it to Cobra and shoot the show right there. Okay, so I'll begin by sharing my screen with the first example. I have a goal with this first example, which is to bring everybody up to speed. I know some people in the audience watching may already know a lot about DMX, and other people might not know anything about DMX. So this first simple example is going to give you enough of a background that you can follow what's going on with the next two. So whether you know a lot or just a little, I think you'll be able to follow this first example. I'm going to begin by importing a background screen, a backdrop, and scripting my flames against the backdrop. So I'm using Finale 3D right now. I'm going to use this feature to add an image and select an image that I have of the Stanford campus, of Stanford University, because I am about a half mile away from this location right now. I thought it would be nice to use that as my backdrop. I have some parameters that I can set here. Everything can pretty much be the default, except I'm going to darken it a little bit so that it looks like night instead of looking like day. Okay? Now, since we just imported this background picture, yet we're in 3D software, you might wonder what we're actually looking at. The background picture was imported as a big billboard in the back of the screen. You can see it here when I rotate the screen. So this is like if you were next to the freeway and you walked straight up against a freeway billboard so you couldn't see anything else, it would kind of look like that was your world. So this is fine. But since we're going to be doing flames, I'd like to move these positions up a little bit closer to the camera. So I'm going to go to the top view here and drag these forward a little bit. Okay, that's fine. There we go. They're a little larger here, so that you can see the flames more. So look fine. Okay. Now, with DMX, the pieces of hardware that are producing the effects are called fixtures. That's another word for a device or a unit or a machine. So the first step that I'm going to take in scripting this simple flame show is to change my launch positions into DMX fixtures. So I'll just select the positions, right click on them, and say configure position as DMX fixture. And I'm going to choose what kind of fixture it is. For this example, I'm going to use a flame projector called the X2 Wave Flamer from the company called X-Flow. And the reason I'm choosing this one is that it has the ability to shoot flames at multiple angles. As we look at this dialogue, I'm going to take a short detour here to give you a little bit of the foundations of DMX so that we can move forward all on the same page. A fixture like this X-Flow X2 wave flamer that can shoot flames in multiple directions needs multiple channels of information to convey the effect that you're asking it to do. Obviously, you need to convey the angle. You also need to be able to convey that you want the flame to turn on and to turn off. So there are at least two. Turns out there are about six channels of information that you need for the X-Plo wave flamer. And we have nine positions here on the screen. We're going to turn all nine of those positions into X-Plo wave flamers, so we could shoot a show with nine different wave flamers here. We'll get to that in the fancy example. But for right now, in the simple example, all I have to do is select a range of DMX channels that are going to be used for each of these fixtures. There are nine fixtures. I think I told you that each uses six. So we need nine times six. We need 54 different channels are going to go into this. Well, this is pretty easy to do. All I have to do is check this box. And Finale is going to automatically assign a channel range to each one of these different fixtures. And I'll show you what that looks like. Here's the list of positions, positions 1 through 9. And over on the right is the channel range of DMX channels used by each of those positions. So I see position 1 here uses 1 through 6. Position 2 uses 7 through 12, and there's no overlap. You'll get in trouble if you overlap. Okay, great. So we're set to go. This simple example will just include three flame shots, one to the left, one up, and one to the right. Then we'll export it for Cobra, and that will be the end of the example. So I've selected this position in the middle. I'm going to right click on it and say add DMX effect to fixture, and I'll pick from the list of effects that are available for this type of fixture. And I'm just going to choose a standard flame here, standard flame. And it inserted it into the show and on the timeline and in the script window. So there's one row here for that standard flame shot. Here it is. Okay. Having done that, I'm going to just grab the little trajectory at the top and angle it over to 60 degrees to the left. So now it's shooting to the left. Okay. Then I'll add another one. Add DMX effect, standard flame. I'll leave that one aiming straight up. Left, straight up. And then I'll add one more and I'll move it to the right. This is our show. The simple example has just three flame effects in it. Left, up, and right. But we need to export it to the Cobra module controller so that we could shoot the show. I need to now step back for the second detour and tell you one more thing about DMX. The way DMX hardware works, sometimes there can be spurious signals in the wire. And this has nothing to do with Cobra and nothing to do with any manufacturer specifically. It's just kind of the way the protocol works. And that makes it a little dangerous when you're using a flame machine, because it means it's possible that one of those spurious signals could cause the flame projector to actually fire when you're plugging in one of your cables. So most flame projectors, not all, but most flame projectors will require that you add a safety channel to enable the fixture for a specific period of time. So I'm going to do that too here. I'll right click, add an effect just like we've already done, except this time I'm going to scroll down to the bottom and add the safety channel effect. Here it is. I'll just drag it over here to the left and I'll adjust its duration so that it's covering that period. If you look at the timeline here, here's the safety channel, this dotted line, if I drag it left and right. And then here are our three effects, the one on the left, the one in the center, and the one on the right. the width of the bar here is the duration in the show. So you'll actually see as I scrub the playhead over, it's kind of on, and it should turn off right about there. On, turn off right about there. On, turn off right about there. And the safety channel is going to turn off right there. Okay, that is our entire show for this first example. So all we have to do now is address it and export it for the Cobra controller, which we'll do by address show. Pick Cobra version 6. No errors. The show is now addressed and ready to export. And then we go to export, export firing system script. We're exporting for Cobra. And we just exported the script. Now, I'm going to show you what that script that we just exported looked like, because actually the script is going to show you that behind the scenes, there are a few things happening that you don't see when you're just designing the show. It actually takes a little bit more than what we're looking at here to get this all to happen. I'll put this into Notepad so you can see it in larger text. So here is the exported Cobra script. And this should look pretty familiar to you, except that the descriptions are kind of long here. So if you are familiar with Pyro for Cobra, maybe your description just looks like red peony. Or blue chrysanthemum, or something like that. So that should look a little bit more familiar to you. So this is the same thing, except that the description is, oh darn, the description is a little bit longer. It includes the name of the effect. So here are these standard flames. It includes the part number or product ID of that effect. It tells you what position. We were using position 5 in the middle. And then it tells you over here what attribute or DMX parameter this particular row in the script happens to be controlling. So if you read down here, angle, speed, ignition. So this example had three effects in it, right? Left, up, and to the right. So let's separate it out and take a look at what's going on here. Here's the safety channel. Here's this first effect. Here's the second effect, here's the third effect. When I mentioned to you that it takes multiple channels of information to produce the effect, you're seeing the multiple channels right here. When we were looking at Finale, the script just had one row here in the script for each of the three effects and the safety channel. Now you can see that when we export the script, each of those rows representing a flame actually got expanded into 3. It could have been expanded into as many as 6 for this particular fixture, but only 3 were necessary. It had to specify the angle, the speed at which the nozzle on the fixture moved to that angle, and the ignition. The channel range, I told you we would go back to this window, the channel range for position number 5 was 25 to 30. Those were the range of channels allocated to this fixture. So as we look at the script, if you can remember off the top of your head how Cobra scripts work, this number here is the DMX channel here, 25 and 26 and 27. And you'll notice that that actually corresponds to 25 plus 0, 25 plus 1, and 25 plus 2. The angle, the speed, and the ignition are at offsets 0, 1, and 2 in that range of 6 channels from 25 to 30. So I'm showing you this so you can understand basically what's going on behind the scenes. But once you understand it, you don't have to pay a lot of attention to it, because you don't really need to look at this script at all. You need to download it to your Cobra controller, but that's it. These can be pretty complicated because a lot of parameters have to get set, but all you need to look at is the simple script here, which is what you would print out if you printed out a report. The last thing I'm going to show you here in this simple example has to do with time. Look at this script here on the timeline. The flame begins at, and maybe you can see it's probably a little blurry, 5 seconds, right here, 5 seconds. The flame starts at 5 seconds and goes to about 5.6 seconds or so. Okay? 5 seconds. So look at these rows here. The first two rows for this first effect begin at 4.66 seconds, not 5 seconds. And the third one begins at 5. Why would that be? Well, a fixture like this that has a nozzle, and this also applies to moving headlight fixtures, when they move to the angle that you want them to be at, it takes a little bit of time to move. They can only move so fast. So if you want the flame to begin aiming to the left at exactly 5 seconds, you have to be prepared, which means you have to start moving that nozzle to that angle before 5 seconds, so that by the time it gets to 5 seconds, it's already where it needs to be. For those of you who do pyro, this is kind of like a pre-fire. That's why these first two rows set the angle to the angle that we want to be at. In this case, it's the number that corresponds to 60 degrees to the left. Sets the speed to go as fast as possible. I want to be prepared. And those occur about a third of a second before the actual effect turns on with the ignition at 5 seconds. That pattern repeats for the second two effects. And that explains what's going on behind the scenes with DMX for a simple show like this with just 3 flame effects. That concludes the first example. We have 3 examples. This was the simple flames example. The second example is the fancy flames example. It's going to get a little cooler. And the third example is the interactive moving lights example, where we'll go upstairs and actually shoot off the show in the upstairs room. For the fancy flames example, I'm going to start by deleting those flames. And instead of producing just 3 flame shots, left, center, and right, what I would like is a sweep of a flame to start on the left and sweep over to the right. And then I'm going to sweep back to the left and back and forth a few times at different speeds, and it's going to look really cool. So here we go. We'll start by adding an effect. I'll just add the standard flame again. And I'll move this one to 60 degrees to the left, just like we did before. And now I'll add another effect after it, a couple of seconds later. But this effect is going to be an effect called a move to effect. Move to effect means that instead of being an independent effect, it's going to connect with the effect before it, and it will move from the previous effect's angle to the current effect's angle. So drag this one over to 60 degrees. And then shoot the flame. Moves from the left to the right. Here it is in real time. I told you we would move to the right and then back to the left. So I'm going to hold the control key on my keyboard and click and drag this effect over to the right and move it to the left. That cloned it. So now we have three effects, the original, the move to, which we dragged over to the right, and then the move to, which I just now dragged back over to the left. So here we go. Now it's going sweeping to the right, sweeping back to the left. Let's do that again. I'll select these last two. I'm going to hold the control key and clone them again. So now it'll right, left, right, left, right. Let's do it again. Clone these two. But this time, I'm going to stretch it out a little bit more to make these go a little slower. So the first sweepings are going to be fast, and then it slows down. In fact, I want it to slow down even more than that to be obviously different from the fast ones. Okay, so what I'm hoping here is through this example of Fancy Flames, I'm hoping to get your creative mind starting to think about the kinds of things that you can do with special effects, with flames, with lights, and with integrating those things with pyro as well. So in this little example, I'll add two more to the right here, and that'll be it. Here we go. Right, left, right, left. Slow, slow, right, left, right, left. Okay, that looks pretty good. That's our Fancy Flames example, but it's going a little bit slow for my taste, so I'm gonna select everything and just compress it on the timeline a little bit. Now it'll go faster. Right, left, slow, slow, right, left, right, left. I could even compress it more. Turn this into a Tom and Jerry cartoon. Right, left, right, left. That actually looks pretty cool. Okay. Like the previous example, we need to add a safety channel. So add safety channel. And drag its duration to cover the period of time of activity here. Okay. So sometimes when you're scripting a DMX show, you can do the hard work at the beginning and then you can get some extra benefit from all of your hard work by replicating what you've done on other fixtures. In DMX, it's called master-slave relationship. When one of your positions is the master, it has all of the effects that you've defined in it, and the slave fixtures are just mimicking what the master does. We can do that here, and we don't have to add any lines to our script at all. All we're going to do is we're going to signal that these fixtures over here, 1 through 4 and 6 through 9, are slave effects to the master, number 5. I'll select these 8 positions. Configure them, and instead of master fixture, I'll just change them to slave. Now, in a large show, you may have multiple masters and multiple slaves, and you have to indicate which master the slave is connected to. The way that you do that is you set the slaves to the same DMX channel base as the master that they are referring to. If you remember looking at the script, our master began with the channel base 25. It used channels 25 through 30. So if we set these slaves to look at channel 25 also and to be slaves, they're going to then do the same thing that the master does. Here we go. Let's watch again. Okay, that's looking pretty good. I'll show you one more thing in this Fancy Flames example. Another feature of DMX fixtures is the ability to mirror the fixture or tilt reverse or pan 180. There are some different words that describe basically the same thing, which is just to say some of these flat slave fixtures will do what the master fixture does, except mirrored or in reverse. It adds some variety to your choreography. It can look pretty cool. So I'll select this one, this one, this one, and this one. Right click on them, configure them again. And this time I'm gonna change their DMX fixture angle to be mirrored or pan 180. Now when we see the show. So we've just been doing this for about 10 or 15 minutes for this example. And you can see we've already got something that looks pretty cool. So I'm hoping that this will be inspirational in a way that you can see how you can combine flames, special effects, and in a moment, light fixtures, along with pyro to make some really creative and engaging shows. We'll conclude this example by addressing it and exporting it again for Cobra, just like you saw in the previous example. We'll address the show, no errors. Export the show for Cobra. And this is what it looks like. Let's just take a quick look. Here's the top one is the safety channel. The next two rows in the exported script behind the scenes are setting the speed and angle using that standard flame effect. And then all of the rest of them are moving left and right and left and right. You can see angle, ignition. Here it turns it on. Then it's gonna leave it on for 2.5 seconds while swiping the angle left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, and so forth. Okay, that's it for the second example, the fancy flames example. We have one more example. This example is going to be interactive. First, I'm going to show you the show file that corresponds to the video that Drew showed you at the beginning of the presentation. Then we'll delete all the effects and we'll script just a little bit ourselves with some moving head lights, doing some of the kinds of effects that people do in light shows. Then we'll walk upstairs to that same room that's pictured in the video and we'll shoot off the show. Here is the show I already have loaded up, corresponding to the video that you saw at the beginning of the presentation. You can see as I scrub through it, the simulations of the lights are doing about the same thing as you saw in the actual video. Here, I'll play about 10 or 15 seconds of it so you can see what's going on. Right, the image in the background is just a snapshot that I took on my iPhone yesterday. This is the room that we're going to walk up to in a couple of minutes. Now that you've seen the video of the actual show, and you've also seen a little bit of what it looks like when you're scripting, I'm going to delete everything in this show and start from scratch. We'll script a few of the little things that you see in a light show. And I'm hoping this is also going to get your creative minds thinking about what you can do. The blue squares here are the fixtures or the moving head lights. The first thing I'm going to do is select one of those fixtures and I'll add a light to it. I'm going to add a move in black effect. You might be wondering, what does move in black mean? Well, this goes back to what I was showing you with the flames, where I told you at the beginning, if you wanted to have a flame that began at 5 seconds, then you'd have to start moving that nozzle before 5 seconds in order to be prepared. The same goes for lights. So a lot of the time, if you're going to do a moving head light effect where the light begins at an angle and then sweeps to a different angle, the event signifying the initial angle is called move in black because it's indicating that leading up to that period of time, the light needs to be prepared, but it can be black for that whole time because while it's moving, you don't want the light to be on. So that's the move in black effect, and that can go straight up just like that. Then I'll add a red move to effect to the same fixture, and I'll rotate that all the way down to 90 degrees. This is going to start to look a little familiar here. So you might be wondering, why are we getting two fixtures? Well, the answer to that question also goes back to the flame example. I have the fixtures on the right set up as slave fixtures to the fixture on the left. And I also have them mirrored so that as this one event here moves on this fixture toward the center, the slave fixture does the same thing in mirror angle also going toward the center. So here we go. We've got a red swoop. Let's add another one. Let's add another move in black. And after it, let's add another move to, but this time let's make it a blue one. And well, actually, for this one, let me make the move in black aim to the right. And then the angle that is the destination angle, the two angle, is going to be straight up. So it's going to go in the opposite direction. Let's play it again. Great, I think that's just fine. I'll select those two and clone them again so we get a duplicate of it. And now I have one other effect that I want to do for you, which is called a flyout. This is a standard effect that's used a lot of the time in light shows. It's pretty cool where the lights are going to move just like we saw here, except instead of moving from left to right, they're going to move toward the audience. So I'm going to select these positions here and begin by adding another move in black, aiming up, and then I'll go to a later time and add a, we'll make these white, add a white move too. I'm gonna rotate these down toward the audience, so it's going to shoot out toward us as the viewer. You can actually see this here. When we're looking at it from the front view, looks like this. That's perfect. Let's do it once again. I'm going to clone it and do it at the beginning as well. And let's reverse the angles here at the beginning so that it starts out aiming forward and goes up. So these guys here. Angle to 90 degrees. these guys here I'll angle up to zero. Okay, I like everything, except it's going a little too slowly, so I'm gonna grab it and compress it a little bit here. Okay, so this is our show. We've got a fly out, maybe that's called a fly in, when it goes in reverse, I'm not sure. We have a couple of moving ahead light sweeps, and then we have a fly out like this. We don't need a safety channel because these are just lights. Let's move them to the beginning so we don't have too long to wait when we export it and run it. So I'm about to address this and export it for the Cobra, but at this moment, I'm going to walk upstairs, as I told you I would, to the room that is pictured here. And I'm going to turn on the hazer to add some haze to the room. This is going to make a little bit of noise, but it's important. Okay, now, so you aren't just looking at me, I want to show you that you're in that room that is pictured. There's the hazer that's going to add a little bit of haze to this room so that you can see the lights. We'll give that a minute to start filling the room. And while it fills the room, we'll export the script for Cobra. Just like before, we'll address the show for Cobra firmware version 6. And just like before, we'll export the script. Unlike before, this time I'm going to export the script to a thumb drive. So I can transfer it the Cobra controller. Looks good. It's on the thumb drive now. Let's go back upstairs, plug the thumb drive into the Cobra controller, and start the show. It's getting a little bit more harder to breathe in here as the hazer fills the room. I've got this. Here's my Cobra controller. Put the thumb drive in the Cobra controller and turn it on. We'll see some lights.
If you want to unshare your screen, Will, I don't know if you want to do that or not, so we can see if you want to show the full video. There you go.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that, Scott. This is the thumb drive that I plugged into the Cobra controller here, and it downloaded. So now I'll turn on the module, give it a second to get started, and then we'll download it from the controller to the module. While I wait here, I'll show you the room. There's the upper ledge. And there are the fixtures that we actually scripted there on the floor. So when we shoot this show,
those fixtures on the floor are going to be the ones that you saw that was scripted. Okay. So next up, press the arm key. And it's downloading now. The cover module doesn't take too long. It's all complete, so we're ready to go. Okay. So here's what happens next. I'm going to turn off the light. I'm going to hold the laptop up against the back wall so that you can see the light fixtures. And then I'm going to press the one key on the Cobra controller to start the show. Here we go. The lights are off. And holding the laptop up, and here goes the show. Okay, so I don't want any applause for that show because I screwed up. And you may have noticed that the show that you just saw was different from what we scripted. And I'll use that as an example to explain why. So with pyro, generally one angle is all you need because the effects are usually for a particular position, always going left to right or always going front to back. But with these moving headlight fixtures, they can swivel and they can tilt. So they have multiple angles that need to be specified. And when I set up the show here, I forgot to specify one of the angles. So that when we shot the show, some of those light fixtures were kind of rotating, they were swiveling at the same time that they were trying to show their beams, and it ended up looking different from what we scripted. So it's no problem. I just have to set the pan angle of those effects as I should have done the first time around. That's all I had to do there is copy the 90 degree pan angle to the effects that didn't have it. And then we will address again for the Cobra and export it again. Well, it was a little hard to breathe when I went up to the room the last time.
We don't want you to pass out, Will.
So this video might be my last video.
Yeah, we know.
Okay.
Who's the haze? Did him in.
I think it's
all think right. Worth it. I'll get lots of YouTube video comments. Okay, we just exported again. The fixed show. So let's go back upstairs now and try again.
One of the big questions, Will, if you can hear me still,
yeah,
is that you'll probably want to answer that's been come up a couple times in the chat in the Q&A. After you do the demonstration, if you will, is they talk a little bit about, you know, different DMX devices that may or may not be supported within Finale, and kind of what the process would be if they wanted to, say, control a DMX device that may or may not be supported, that they end up owning or purchasing. So
yeah, that's a super great question. That's from somebody who is sophisticated about DMX and knows what's going on. Because it's so the quick answer is that you can create an effect library in Finale as a user for a new fixture that Finale knows nothing about. Kind of the same way that you can create simulations in Finale for fireworks effects arbitrarily. You can also do that for DMX fixtures. And when you do that, you have to also specify what's called the DMX personality, or that specific meaning of the range of channels that correspond to the attributes of the device. It's a little complicated to do. So at this stage in the game, what we're offering to do is to do it for you. So if you have a fixture and you want to script your show for it, if you would just tell us what the fixture is, be specific, tell us what the model and brand is, and send us the user manual, the link to the user manual, we will add it to Finale for you, so you don't have to do your own effects. All right. Well,
the audience wants you to shoot it off so they don't see it pass out. It looks like it's building up in there. So
all right, here we go.
We want to make sure you're alive and well.
Lights are off. I believe I have armed the module. It just downloaded. And now I will hold the laptop and shoot the show a second time. All right. So that time.
That was my applause. I
don't know if you could hear it. That time it worked, so you can applause. I'm going to try to make it out of the room before there are consequences. Okay. So I mentioned at the beginning that I would give three examples. The first one to show you some basics of DMX. The second one to get your creative minds thinking about what you can do with flames and special effects. And the third one to add lights to the mix, and also to make it real time so you could see us end to end, design a show from scratch, export it to the Cobra controller, download it to the module, press the one button on the Cobra controller, and watch the show. So we're all done. Drew, let me turn back to you and let you take over.
All righty, thanks, Will. I am going to go ahead and share my screen here. I'm just watching the chat and the Q&A. Some pretty interesting interactions and lots of questions about how do I do this? So definitely some excitement there. All right, let me try to share my screen. And I just want to quickly show, you should be seeing my web browser here with the Finale 3D homepage. And I just want to quickly show this for anyone who's not currently using Finale 3D out there in the audience. If you'd like to give Finale 3D a try, you can do that completely for free. Visit finale3d.com. Go to the download page, let that load up here. And if you want to download the latest full release, you just choose the download button at the top of the page. The release notes are below. Once you've downloaded and installed the software, you can create an account. If you don't have one already, And then that'll allow you to run the software in a free trial mode. And the free trial mode allows you to test most of the features of the hobbyist version. It doesn't allow you to save or export your shows though. I want to mention also that there's a list of releases of builds of the software underneath the latest release. So I'm going to collapse the release notes. And then you'll see all of the previous releases, including the beta versions. So I want to mention that sometimes you'll find, as is the case today, that the latest release, the full stable release, was released on April 6th, whereas since the April 6th, we've had a series of beta releases, which include lots of small tweaks and improvements. And we will eventually or ultimately promote those beta release, that one of the beta releases, to being a full release once we confirm that it's stable. So if you want to run the latest stable release, grab the green release download at the top of the page. If you want to grab the latest cutting edge release, which may have some new fixtures incorporated in it as we work on incorporating more and more fixtures, that's the case here. And then you want to grab the latest beta version. So I wanted to go through that and just explain that a little bit. I will also mention that if you do download the latest release here today, any of the versions on the page, whether it's the latest beta or the latest full release, and you experiment with lights, you're not going to see the simulations for the moving lights that you saw in Will's demo. Those are still in internal testing. The show that you saw was designed, the show that we showed at the top of the hour was designed in Finale 3D without light simulations, so the design can be done. You just don't have the visualization of the lights quite yet, but that'll be coming out very, very soon. So stay tuned for that. And with that, I think we'll jump over to the Q&A and turn it into a bit of a group discussion. So what do we got here, guys? Will, we got a question from Greg Robertson. It says, can you explain safety channel?
Sure. The safety channel is just one of the channels in the DMX personality of the fixture that has to be set to a specific value in order to enable the fixture. And the reason that it's there is that it's unlikely if you jiggled your wires or your cables that you would accidentally or spuriously get both the value of the safety channel kind of in the range of enabling it and also the value that ignites or turns on the device in the case of flame. So it's a safety precaution by just making it less susceptible to spurious signals in the DMX stream. And as you saw in Finale, it's just an effect that you add at the beginning and set the duration to be the whole show, and you don't have to think about it any more than that.
Well, there's a follow-up question on that. Will there be an error if the safety channel is missing?
Yeah, it depends on the fixture, because some fixtures don't have safety channels. In fact, even some flame fixtures don't have safety channels, the ones that are kind of unsafe. But like the German ones, they all have safety channels. The Chinese one, sometimes. If the fixture requires a safety channel, you'll get an error when you try to address the show that says, hey, this fixture requires a safety channel, you need to add one.
I'm gonna throw up a poll while we wait for some more Q&A. Just informational poll here. Just looking to see what you're gonna use DMX for. And it's multiple choice, so select any that apply.
Thanks, Joel. There's one other question, Will, and I'll let you take this one. I can help out too, but this falls a little bit in my area. The question is there documentation videos to cover using DMX with Finale 3D and Cobra in detail? And obviously they acknowledge the webinar will be posted, but we barely scratched the surface on DMX overall.
Yeah, why don't we both take this one? First of all, actually, maybe it's easier for you to take the whole question, Drew, because I think the question covers both text documentation and also videos.
Yeah. So I think the first thing to note is that, if you're joining us today, we're on the bleeding edge of where we're headed. And some of the features that we showed are still just very early on. And we're pinning some things down. So you can expect that a lot of tutorials and documentation will come out over time. I'll go ahead and share my screen though and show you that we already have a really good set of documentation for DMX. So let me do that right now. And we'll be continuing to add those. In terms of videos, as Will alluded to while I'm getting this ready, we will also have tutorial videos. Those take a little bit more time. So those will be coming out as well as soon as the software is polished and released. So let me pop open the software documentation here from the main menu on the Finale 3D website. And then we have a variety of topics and you can scroll down here and you'll see a section on DMX starting here. So we've got this carved into different categories. So you've got DMX basic instructions. That's a great starting point. And these articles do address everything needed to do a basic DMX show. Not necessarily all of the things you might need yet, but we're fleshing this out and the new documentation is added all the time. So you have basic DMX, lighting, lighting fixtures, flame and spark instructions. And I want to give Will a lot of credit here, or all the credit here, because he's done pretty extensive work on this documentation. So this list reflects all of the firing systems and all of the fixtures that are currently being supported. Videos, tutorials will definitely be coming out over time. So Will, anything to add on this?
No, that's great. But I just want to reiterate the answer to that earlier question that if somebody has a DMX fixture and wants to get started using Finale to script for it, just email us, service@finale3d.com, and tell us your fixture name and send us the user manual or a link to it, PDF, and we will add effects for it. Depending on what the fixture is, we may or may not be able to add simulations. So if it's a flame system or if it's a lot of the light systems, we'll be able to add simulations. If it's bubbles or confetti, we may not have great simulations for that right away. Sometimes you have to use placeholder effects. The show that we demonstrated at the beginning, we showed you a video at the beginning. At the time that we scripted that show, we didn't have any light simulations at all. So we just had kind of ground flares indicating the color of the lights. So you can get started even if your particular fixture type doesn't have simulations.
One other thing to note too on the documentation, on the flip half of that, which is the Cobra side of it, at ourhelp.cobrafiringsystems.com, basically our help portal, there's a user guide section. Within there, there's a user guide on DMX, and we talk about introductions to the basic concepts of universe, channel value, pulse time, and then there's also a little section in there that talks briefly about Finale as well. There's an article, but you know, with regards to like Will was going through some of the script, raw script formats, that's all documented in detail there, and I actually think it's also detailed on the Finale's website as well, too. So, and also, if you do ask us any questions, we'll certainly do our best to help out on the Finale side as well. Or if we can't answer it, we'll direct you in their direction. So no matter what funnel you go through, we should be able to get you to the right person.
Well, I have another poll I'll go ahead and throw up there while we wait for some more questions.
Hosts and panelists cannot vote. What's that about?
Yeah.
I figured that would skew the results a little bit, right?
Yeah.
No, I haven't heard of it.
Till today.
Safety. Tom in Q&A said safety channel sounds like a combination. Dead man and trigger channel used in Cobra. It's kind of in a way, it's kind of a dead man, specifically on the unit, right? So
that question actually brings up an interesting thought, doesn't it, Scott? I mean, you could almost imagine kind of connecting the safety channel to a physical button or something like your dead man. I don't know if we'd work that out, but it's an interesting thought because the concepts do seem very closely related.
Yeah, no, that could be eventually actually tied into some of, I think, the disabled firing features that we're working on, that they can actually get down specifically to devices and such.
So just shared the results of that last poll. Thought it was a little interesting. You might want to look at it. It looks like 7 people pro, 6 people hobbyist, 9 do not have it, and 1 person said, what is Finale? 3 do.
Wasn't me.
I saw a question here. What is the turnaround on getting custom DMX requests completed? That depends on the device, on the fixture. Some of them are hard and some are easy. Usually I can do it in a couple of days. So, maybe a week on average is the turnaround time between when you send me the PDF and I send you back a effect library.
So it's still pretty promising for getting some fixtures in potentially before the 4th. That question referenced the 4th of July. So we can, sooner we hear from you, sooner we can get it in.
Excellent. A couple more just popped in. Scripted show 3D.
Drew, why don't you take the first question? This about visualizations.
Yeah, I'm not sure actually what this refers to. How are you interpreting the
question? Oh, I'm just thinking that we have a YouTube channel that has a bunch of sims. We don't have sims yet of the lights, because that's literally just the light simulations are just kind of coming out right now. But we have lots of sims of Pyro. Maybe you could show them where that is, Drew.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me do a quick screen share here. Sorry for bouncing around. So you can visit youtube.com/finale3d. If you're on our website, the Finale 3D website, we also have a menu for videos, and that will lead you to the YouTube channel. From the YouTube channel, we have a variety of playlists, including tutorials, our announcement for tonight's event. And in addition to that, we have a playlist for competitions that we've held. And we've had a couple very large pyromusical design competitions, and they include many videos. Here you can see this playlist has 57 different videos of shows. So that includes countless simulations, visualizations, different scenery, things like that. And then the same for a contest that we held last year in July. So there's lots and lots of content there. If you're looking for something specific, feel free to reach out. Again, Will mentioned our email address. If you ever need to find the best way to contact us, we have that email address listed down here in the bottom of the page, support@finale3d.com. So you can always email that and one of us will get back to you right away with anything specific that you're looking for.
I can answer this question from Greg about safety channels. So he's asking, did I say that you only need one safety channel per show? Say you have 2 flame events, 15 minutes apart. Can you just add a safety channel at the beginning of the first one and stretch it all the way 15 minutes of nothingness to the second one? It's an excellent question. And the answer to that question depends on your fixture. So for a lot of fixtures in which the safety channel is just a logical enable or disable flag, basically, then it's just fine if you have 2 periods of activity separated by 15 minutes or however long of inactivity to just add the safety channel at the beginning and stretch its length to be the entire length, and that's fine. It's a little bit more safe if you're going to have people walking around in the area in between to disable the safety channel in the period of inactivity, if that's a safety consideration for you. But that's entirely up to you. So for most fixtures, it's entirely up to you whether you have one safety channel covering your whole show, or whether you have safety channels that you've adjusted and positioned the durations of to kind of cover the specific periods of activity. There are some fixtures for which it does matter though. So some fixtures' safety channel has additional meanings connected with it. So some flame fixtures, the safety channel actually means safety channel and pilot light. And there are some flame fixtures for which the pilot light has to be on at least 10 seconds before your effect. So you need to start that one kind of 10 seconds early. And there are other fixtures for which you can't leave it on for longer than 5 minutes of continuous operation. So for those, you can't leave that one on for a 15-minute period of inactivity because it would overheat. So for those, for that particular fixture, you'd have to kind of shrink down your safety channel to cover just the specific periods of activity. And sometimes for some of these really specific fixtures, you might even have to incorporate that constraint into the design of your show. But that's the unusual case. By far the most common case is that it's entirely up to you. The safety channel is just an enabling flag. And you know, I would say 95% of the time, that's the case and it's up to you.
Yeah, just to tack on before we go to the next question, I would say if you're in the audience and you're thinking, how am I gonna know what I need to do? The answer is there are differences between hardware, and when you buy the hardware, you're gonna get at least some basic instruction manual, and the instruction manual is going to tell you what you need to know to make the fixture work, or a little bit of experimentation is gonna help you figure that out in combination with, of course, Finale and your Cobra gear. So you'll be able to figure that out pretty quickly. So there's not a universal, I think Will's overarching point here is like, there's all sorts of differences between fixtures, and it'll just depend on your specific fixtures that you own, and you'll learn to operate those once you have them. So we have another question. I think this is a good one for the Cobra guys.
Yeah, I can answer that. So, will the same module, for example, the 36M or the 72M that supports DMX, fire pyro in addition to firing DMX? And the short answer to that is yes, it can. In fact, first off, it can do it effortlessly in the sense that it doesn't matter how much DMX you're outputting or how much pyro that you're shooting, each can operate effectively at its maximum output capacity, number of cues, timing resolution, you name it, without impacting the other. So you don't have to worry about, oh, am I doing too much DMX? Maybe that's going to impact the pyro, vice versa. Secondly, I think it's important to note that in the Cobra sphere in our world, the pyro channels that are assigned to each of the banks on the 36M and the 72M are entirely independent from the universe assignment on the module itself. So for example, if you set the module to say universe one, right, that does not dictate what channel you have to set the module to, for example, channel one or channel two or anything of that nature. So each have their own unique, in a generic term, addressing abilities on both the universe and the pyro firing capability that are independent and unique and uninfected by one another.
That's Scott, that's great. What you basically said is you get an entire additional system for just the module you already have, and you can already do everything else you could already do completely simultaneously with no limitations.
That's right. For the
there's
for
no
the
downside.
For the low and easy price of $89.99.
There you go.
Upgrading your module and yeah. For a free firmware upgrade, so no cost.
Adding on to that question, someone asked, Chris asks, does DMX draw a lot of power from the battery? I think he's referring to the batteries that are in the Cobra modules.
Negligible would be how I would state that. That's actually a really good question. What I can tell you is that that's a great question. That's actually something that I can't specifically answer. I can tell you that, and we mentioned this in our webinar yesterday, that We've done some maximum load testing, I'll give you one specification. We achieved 8 devices across around 2,000 feet, I think it was 1,900 feet of cable simultaneously. We think it can actually go higher than that. But it should have a fairly negligible impact on the battery life. Certainly nothing substantial, at least at this stage, that we've done to re-specify or change the overall battery life of the system. But I do believe that it is important for us to quantify that a little bit further for individuals, which that was a great question. So,
Scott, I think correct me if I'm wrong, I think we should clarify that the DMX in the DMX and powering the fixtures is not synonymous.
If you
have a light, you need AC power. Normally 110 power, you're going to need power in the field. That's not coming from the Cobra module. The Cobra module is really just communicating the signals that are needed to activate the light, move the, you know, it's sort of the instruction set, not the main source of power for the fixture.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really great point, Drew. Absolutely, yeah. So we're not powering the DMX lights. Like it's different with the E-matches and igniters or whatever you're using. Our batteries are physically firing those. Right. In this case, we're purely just effectively just a digital signal across a line. No different than really like a 2-wire system for that matter.
All right. Let's see. There's one here. How does Pyro and DMX look like in Finale 3D? I think that's referring to simulations. And as we've talked about a little bit, Pyro, I'm not totally sure I understand the question entirely, but I'll just say that, Pyro is simulated fairly well in Finale 3D now, and flames are simulated very well. And the lights are simulations for lights we kind of showed tonight, Will, during the demo. And if you missed that part, you can see the recording in the next few days when Ryan and the guys get it up on Cobra's site. And we'll be releasing the version of Finale that you can use light simulations yourself very soon. Anything to add to that, Will? You're on mute at the moment.
No, thanks. No, that's a great explanation. Coming soon.
All right. And then there's one more here, just says, I'm attracted to the Q value and pulse time benefits of adding. I think they're referring to the DMX add-on for Cobra. So it's more of a thumbs up than anything else. So that rounds out.
Thanks, Tom.
Q&A. Yeah.
All right. Well, I guess we can, it looks like we don't have any more Q&A or comments within the chat, which normally when we get to that point, we can kind of just say a lot of thank yous and then kind of break for what is kind of like the after party post Q&A, if there's some straggling questions out there, and then we just kind of hang out and then kind of cut ties. So, but anyway,
Add one more thing before we kind of let people go.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Some final words. I wanted to mention all of the DMX fixtures that you saw in the room when I carted the computer upstairs and showed you, all of that stuff, including the hazer, I got from Amazon, and it cost about $1,800 for everything in the room that was used for the show that you saw the video of. So it's like pennies. Like, the stuff is so cheap. For $100, a little bit more than $100, you can get a moving head light fixture. A hazer is just $150 or something like that. You can get lasers, all kinds of stuff. And it's all very cheap. So if you're wondering kind of what you need to get into this in terms of money, not very much. So I'm hoping, it used to be the case that even just 5 or 10 years ago, that light fixtures for moving heads and the kinds of stuff that you see at concerts were a lot more expensive, thousands or even thousands. Even tens of thousands in some cases of dollars. And so it was not accessible to the average guy. And now with Cobra's DMX control and scripting from Finale, you can design and buying stuff from Amazon or eBay or Alibaba, you can design shows
with all kinds of stuff in it. And I have a feeling, I have a hope, I have an expectation that, you know, the folks, like the people who are on this webinar today, are really going to produce some creative things that the world hasn't seen before, because it's just all there for us to do. So appreciate your taking the time.
No, thank you, Will. That's absolutely true. Absolutely. Yeah, definitely echo that. There's some crazy cool stuff that you even mentioned, like bubble makers and confetti. Like, there's just crazy stuff that you can do out there with DMX devices, and just how incredibly affordable it is. And especially for things that aren't necessarily safety critical. Like, you know, there's one thing to buy, like, you know, a flame device that you stick like a butane canister into it that you'd normally use to fill your lighter, right? With no safety channel. And then there's, you know, the ability to use those really inexpensive RGB lights and place them on positions with one module across, you know, a 200-foot front to simulate things like flame pots or you know, strobing pot type effects, and without actually having using pyro, you know, especially now in a time where pyro is kind of difficult to purchase, at least this year, it's very cost effective. So I think you're dead on, and I'm super excited, especially at events like PGI. I'd love to see DMX, because just historically you don't see that really during pyro shows, and how cool would that be to see, especially hopefully driven much on the consumer end of it as well. So
I just love the idea of the fact that I don't have to think about the additional setup time or cost to turn the light on again.
Yeah.
Like I can wash it across. I can put a roll of them on the street in front of my house and wash them across my house as many times as I want. And it doesn't really cost me much difference.
Yeah.
Like that's the beautiful thing. Like, and you know, that's, I didn't mention that at the top, but like, you know, you have pyro, it's consumed, right? If you're designing a show, every time you add something, that's dollars. If you have flames, you have the fuel, that's a nominal cost. For lights, sparks, same kind of thing. But for lights, it's like, use it as much as you want. And, you know, you can have your own nightclub in your bedroom like Will does. And, you know, it's pretty fun. I need a hazer too.
So, need a hazer.
Yeah. There's a couple more questions that came in. Scott, shall we take those?
Oh, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, from Joshua. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm really glad that Joshua asked this question, because Will and I neglected to mention this. Finale 3D Hobbyist, which is the lower cost version of Finale 3D, has all of the DMX capabilities that the pro version has. So you can do everything that you saw tonight in the Hobbyist version. You do not need Finale 3D Pro. Will, anything to add there? All right. We have another general question about Finale 3D. Is it easy to simulate? This is not a DMX question. Is it easy to simulate cakes that are not from one of the listed suppliers? The answer is, I like to think yes. I like to think that is the claim to fame of Finale. I like to think that the ability to type a description of the cake with some, you know, minimal studying of some documentation and tutorials, and you can absolutely create cakes that are not in the supply. In fact, I would say that, you know, the supplier catalogs today, although we are adding to them regularly and we are bringing more suppliers on board almost weekly, there's always going to be hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of cakes that aren't built in. And we are trying to make it as easy as possible to add cakes that we don't have in there now. So we have, I'm not going to get too in depth on it, but there's documentation on it. We have video tutorials on doing that. And of course, for anything you can't find help with in a self-serve way, you can contact us, support@finale3d.com, and we'll provide some one-on-one training or tutorial videos to get you going. So let us know how we can help.
Well, excellent. All right. Anyone else wants to add at this point? Okay. All right. Well, geez, great job, Will and Drew. You guys crushed it. So that was really helpful, super informative. It's quite obvious that Finale can do some crazy awesome stuff. Right. And just watching what's in your bedroom and then imagining that your bedroom's not a small bedroom, but more a you know, a large football field wide.
You're getting there.
Canvas, and just the lights are a little bit bigger and multiplied times three or four. That's some world class crazy stuff. And not to pat Cobra's back at all, but you know, I think doing that from single modules, pretty impressive for the equipment. And I'm really glad that all you guys on the Finale side, you know, Will and I, especially early on, and Drew as well, and working with Joel and everything, took the time to, you know, a lot of the integration that you guys did with Cobra was very well crafted, right? So that wasn't just like flipping on a switch to make that work the way it is. And there's a lot of details that probably will never be appreciated fully that make that simple and easy to just export and then have it run and to optimize and minimize the number of events, you know, which ultimately leads to just a better overall experience by the user. So good job. Okay.
Will there on our side.
Yeah.
I think, you know, for me, I'm not a developer or a programmer, but I would say, like, if you find it elegantly simple to use and it just does what you want, that's a good sign that it's pretty complicated under the hood. So,
oh yeah.
You know, someone's, you guys said, know that.
Exactly. Someone made a quote to me that said, sorry for the length of this letter. I didn't have time to write the short version, I guess was a Mark Twain quote. So oftentimes simplicity comes in more time and effort. And so, all right. Well, cool. So thank you everyone for attending this and for everyone else, both panelists and attendees, for taking the time out of your busy days to be part of this. We're here to help. Super excited for the future. This is just the beginning. And so, yeah, I guess I'll just close it at that. And yeah, normally we can just kind of hang out. If anyone has any other questions, let us know. Obviously, you guys know how to get a hold of us. So thank you.